You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined. I finally got him. We had Rory on 2 years ago for my birthday episode, and it's not quite my birthday episode yet, but I'm Billy, and I'm joined by Robbie McAllister.
Robbie!
I'm so excited.
Speaking of birthday, that was mine like 3 days ago.
Oh, there we go. That's fine. It all works then with the birthday motif I've got going on. I'm really excited about this, to be perfectly honest, because I think I sent a long message to you a while ago. You guys, the Highlanders, were like the first match I ever saw live in WWE in Aberdeen. It was yourselves, first show anyway. And I was just like, I loved you guys because I'm Scottish. I got to see guys in kilts wrestling. What's not to love? And who knew back then that I would end up looking like Rory with the bald head beard? But you know,
you do look like him.
I know.
You look like him for sure.
I think I've probably got the broadness as well. Maybe the fitness, but definitely the broadness of him as well. We'll chat for a bit, I suppose. That's what we do on podcasts. That's the general plan. So usually we go right back to the start a little bit, how you got into wrestling, etc. So we'll start with the cliched podcasting questions when it comes to wrestling shows and what your first memories are of professional wrestling. What was the moment that you watched and went, yeah, I love wrestling?
I think I was about 22, and I always had this dream about being a wrestler when I was a kid, and then I started watching it about like 20 years old. There was a span that I didn't watch it, high school, you know, tipping bottles, maybe smoking some bowls. But I know that at a certain time around 20, it started to come back, and I started hanging out with a couple of guys I played soccer with, and we were starting to watch pay-per-views, and they had went and watched an indie show, and when I went to the indie show, I'm like, if these guys are doing it, there's no way I'm not going to do this, because I'm way bigger than these guys. And I wasn't much bigger than them, but, you know, at that time, I was like, I was hitting the gym hard, and I thought, okay, I can use what going to the gym as, you know, I knew right there that I could do it. And then, you know, the search went on for how we go to find a wrestling school.
So what year are we looking at then for pay-per-view wise?
We're looking at when I started the wrestling school, I started in 2000.
Right. Oh yeah. So I can see why you got back into wrestling then, because that was the big height of the Attitude Era, because that year 2000 was phenomenal, if I remember rightly.
So when I was that age, so I want to say I got back into wrestling about 3 or 4 years prior to that. So that was like right at the Attitude Era, ECW, One Night Stands, you know. So we're looking at a lot of wrestling going on in the business booming at the time. But unfortunately, at the time, that part of the business was booming, but indie wrestling was horrible. Mm. Like when I got onto the scene and got into indie wrestling, you know, it was tough to get on shows, and shows were few and far between in Canada. I mean, because, as everybody knows, I'm not really Scottish, just so we better lay that one down too.
you're as Scottish as Roddy Piper, and we kept him. We adopted Roddy, so you're still one of us.
My family, you know, my grandfather does come from Kirkcaldy area, and so I have roots to Scotland. So and I basically, before I met Rory, I was planning on, you know, paying homage to my grandfather and using his name. So, you know, they chanted, you know, you had to have a ring like HBK, or and mine could be RGK because I could be Robert Graham Cricotti or something, you know. So, but then Rory came along, so it was inevitable to become a tag team because he spoke Scottish, like a good solid Scottish accent. And I could just have to say, "Oh, Robbie."
I needed. So that seems like really like weird coincidence then that you were planning to have your Scottish roots shown and do that, and then just conveniently enough, Rory came into the scene and he was Scottish. You're like, oh, okay, cool. That's how.
And it made it easier. And when you get in and you're trying to get up to the top, it's better to have a guy that you can rely on and be with all the time to, you know, kind of, so you at least have someone watching your back, because, you know, when wrestling ain't always, it's not always nice and roses. It's, you know, it might be the way they say on the internet now that it, you know, backstage is a lot nicer and everybody's friendly and stuff, but everybody's ready to stab you in the back because they want the next, they want the spot.
Mm-hmm.
They want to climb. So.
So tell us about that meeting then. So you met Rory, and that was it. Was it just click straight away, or was there, did you wrestle each other first, train with each other, and then that kind of relationship blossomed? How did that come about?
Well, he came, I want to say it was November of 2000 or something, maybe it was a little later, or maybe it was March of 2001. And we had met and we were at the same wrestling school. So therefore we became friends. I got him work so he could, you know, pursue with his dream and, you know, put food on his table. And I didn't want to stray away from the Scottish character. And it was just easy to do a Scottish tag team because it's really not, it was never really done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, never really saw two guys in kilts before. And so it made it easy. But we weren't, you know, we weren't the big hairy Highlanders at the time either. So
I do. I remember reading a story that when you were coming up to WWE, that it was held off for a minute because, and in that time you guys grew beards and you became just two rugged Scottish dudes because you had that little time in between just to grow out the facial hair, and then that was it.
I know, like when we ended up getting hired, we had. Our beards were coming in. We looked scruffy, and my hair was a lot, you know, it was shorter, but it was getting all crazy. But I want to say there was about a 6 month period we got to grow even more. And I ended up at one point, the size of my beard and everything, I, from a side view, I had this army hat like Sami Zayn always wears. And damn, I look, from a side view, I look like Fidel Castro.
Well, that's the backup character if anything fell through. You know, it was Wild West in the early 2000s. We had Muhammad Hassan. There was no limits to what we could see on TV at that point, which is a terrifying prospect when you think about it. So Scottish character took off, and when I was reading, I use Cage Match as my source of matches, which is probably not the best thing to do. But I was noticing there. Furthest back debut is 2003 for yourself. So was it a bit before then that you got in the ring and were having matches in front of crowds?
I started doing matches in, my first match was, I think it was around June of 2001. And because I had started training, I think it was October, maybe October of 2000s. I can't really remember exactly dates, but I want to say I had a match in June, and then I started, and me and Rory ended up doing indie wrestling up until mid-2004, where that's where we started doing a lot of WWE stuff.
Did you feel you were ready to go that? That seems like a really short time to go from October to June. Is it because there was such a dearth in indie wrestling at that time? There wasn't a lot going on that they were kind of fast tracking, possibly sooner than you needed to.
Well, when we were still, I don't know if I explained it right, but You said from October to June. Oh, for to get in the ring to wrestle.
Yeah.
It all depends. Like, you know, we were okay back then. A lot of guys didn't rehearse as much as they do now. And back then, we would basically have, you know, my first match was 6 minutes, and it was pretty much planned, and we got it spot on, so there was nothing wrong. And then my next match was 12 minutes. I think it was 12 minutes, and I had a pretty good gift to do it, but, you know, if you got lost, you had to grab a hold. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people didn't know holds or anything, so they looked like, what do I do? but I didn't. I was hoping that I'd be in earlier, but I'm glad I stayed longer because I got to get better as a whole to before I actually started getting a lot of matches. But then I want to say from October of 2001, me and Rory might have got we started getting a lot more matches, and even when we worked for WWE. Our first time, I don't think we were ready really, but we had a damn good match with Rhino and Tajiri on Monday Night Heat.
That's one of the notes I've got here, because I one of the guys that I always find underrated was Tajiri, and he's just a guy that when you go back and watch it back in 2000 early 2000s, he was just immense, a ridiculous, like,
yeah, so absolutely. Now, did you get a chance to find that match online and have a look at it, or?
I probably watched it at the time, but I haven't watched it in a good long while.
Okay, I just thought maybe you might have saw it before we did the interview or something.
No, it's just while Ken, it was around about that time I watched everything I possibly could. So I think Heat may have been online at that point. So I was getting the dial up on after 6 o'clock and. Watching Heat on WWE.com and all that kind of stuff, but I always enjoyed watching Tajiri, especially Rhinos. That's just two fairly intense guys for your debut in WWE on Heat.
Yeah, and that was we weren't under contract at that time either. That was when we were two indie guys. Rory got a match earlier. I think with Shelton Benjamin in London, Ontario, the first time we got a chance to get backstage at WWE and maybe get looked at. And then that match was at the Igloo in Pittsburgh. I think it was July. And then from there it started to progress. And we were basically, Rory basically, or I would call Dr. Tom at the office and just say, hey, we're wrestling over by here, and then any chance we could get on those shows this week, and then we really started pushing to try to get into WWE.
So was that always the thought when you guys got together? Was right? Okay, we've got a pretty good team. We've got each other's back. We're just gonna go for it, get into WWE as soon as we can. Or
for me, I worked in an auto factory, and I just got laid off, and I knew that this was my. There was no backup plan. I was like, going to make it. In my head, I was going to make it there. And damn, we did. Rory's had the same plan. Like, so, you know, if you speak the words and do the work, you'll get there. But, you know, sometimes you don't do enough work to stay there. So
what are your memories of doing the promos beforehand? Which was like all about the Highlands, all very stereotypical Highland Scottish stuff, and then pretty much you would just go, "I'm Robbie," and then that was kind of the gist of it. What was your impression and memories of doing that?
It was a lot of fun, but it didn't give me a chance to show them that I had more talent than, you know, I really did. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I was in the tag team, and you know, no matter what, I wasn't going to stab Rory in the back, and we were staying until we at least fired and then go our separate ways if that's what the case was. And it kind of turned out that way. Like after I wasn't at WWE, you know, we did a maybe a handful of tag matches, but I just basically continued on and tried to, you know, hone my skills. And I think life after WWE made me probably a way better wrestler. And I bet you I could go there and wrestle right now. I'm in shape enough. I could.
Never know. So I was going through the matches that you had, like in OVW and things like that, and the names that were popping up was just like future star, future star, future star. I was noticing. It wasn't OVW. It was PWX. Sean Spears popping up in there. Of course, who's just returned to NXT from his time in AEW, and you had The Miz as well on Heat. When you're in the ring with guys that you look back on now, going, I was in the ring when they were in their infancy, do you get kind of a feel that you know that they're good and they can go far, or is there any feeling you have at the time?
I knew, well, I used to work with Sean Spears back in the day, and he came into the same school we did. He ended up going to another one pretty fast. But we worked the indies together, did some travel, a little bit of traveling together. And he's smooth and solid in the ring, you know, so I knew he could go places. And it's nice to see him get a job back there again. I don't know if he'll end up on the main roster and make tons of money, but sometimes that's not our place in wrestling. It's like, you know, we could just like, I don't need to wrestle, but I do. And I do pretty good still on it. And I don't do it a lot, but I don't even have to work if I don't really want to. So I'm in a good position in life.
Mm-hmm. So another matches I was noticing was Parker Holly, who he's got quite a rep. And I think when I remember speaking to Rory, he's kind of saying you guys were quite happy to get a little bit snug if required when the time came to it. Going up against a guy like Holly, was that one of those times?
Well, I didn't mind working with him, but we had an altercation and an incident one time where he started trying to take liberties on me in the ring, and I just kept laughing at him, and he was pissed off, and you know, he said some things. He's working in the ring would be fine with him, but he said some other things personally that he could have just, you know. Mm-hmm. I would like to, yeah.
Bob Holly causing issues with taking liberties. That's not quite the scoop.
But the funny thing is, it's nice to tell the story because, you know, at the time when I was in WWE, the family that my wife and her family, they own like a worldwide company and make equipment. And, he says, Bob Holly says to me, he goes, you ever think about going to work for them? And that was kind of like an insult to me. And funny thing is, I went and worked there for 8 years. And in that time, did a few real estate deals. And now I'm pretty much kind of retired. So I kind of took his advice in a way. So thanks, Bob Holly.
Well, if it makes you feel any better. He did a meet and greet up in Aberdeen once. And you're really supposed to, you pay for whatever, pay for a photo, pay for an autograph. And I was like, I'm not paying him £20. I'll pay for my photograph. I had his book. So I laid his book down and he got so excited. He signed my book. So there you go. I skimmed him out of £10. I don't know if that actually makes up for anything, but it made me happy for a brief moment. Just going, could have got an extra tenner out of me, Bob, but you didn't. Anyway. So
amazing matches with him and Cody. Awesome to work with those guys.
I know, and it's another name that at this point, well, we'll delete as appropriate, is the WWE champion. Oh, had a hard loss 2 years in a row.
I got to work on it.
In one of the biggest main events in probably wrestling history right now, that's happened or hasn't happened. I don't know. We're really kind of on a. We're recording. We're putting this out Monday afterwards. We're recording beforehand, but it's fine. So when I was going. You made your debut on Raw, and you immediately kind of seemed to be so many matches. I noticed you and Kate, you guys and Kaden Murdoch constantly on the house. Well, everything just seemed to be you and Kaden Murdoch.
Yeah, it was loop after loop after loop after loop, and the worst thing was we had a pretty decent match, but they never wanted to do anything more. It's like they didn't trust us, or they tried to control. That's what happens, you know. They're in the agent's pocket or whatever. But the weird thing was, we worked with them that long. We beat them every night. But the weirdest, Umaga was coming up. So what would happen was, before television, we were ever on television, we would beat Kate and Murdoch, and they'd go to the back, and then we'd be coming down the aisle getting cheered, and then Umaga would come out and attack us and beat us up, and then he would come to the ring and do his match. And that was before Umaga was on television.
Right.
Okay. So, but the weirdest thing is, we never ever went to television and worked with Kate and Murdoch. It went straight to the Spirit Squad.
That's the weirdest thing. Yeah, it's when I'm seeing it, saying house show, you guys and Kate and Murdoch, and then TV pops up and it's you against the Spirit Squad or something like that. I'm like, how does this work? kind of thing.
Well, and the weirdest thing was in that September, after we debuted, we did a tour of Mexico, and we ended up working with the Spirit Squad in Mexico, which made sense. But then we also worked with Kate and Murdoch, and I think that was our first loss, but it was just, they made us lose because of where it was on the card and how to do it, but they didn't really want us to lose because Vince still had liked us by then, you know, then. So but the problem was, when we came in, Crime Time came in right after, and that was Vince McMahon's next owner. So you know, things can happen fast, and then things can get shuffled to the wayside pretty fast there. So
what I'm gathering from this little bit here is Vince loves a stereotypical tag team, totally Scottish. I don't know how much I can say about Crime Time without getting cancelled, you know, straight white male. But it was a stereotype at the time, and then you had Spirit Squad, who were the cheerleaders. I mean, you know what? People kind of maybe a bit down in that time of wrestling. I loved it. I love the big characters. That's the wrestling I like. Give me that. Give me more characters nowadays.
It's not there. It's not there anymore, is it?
It's not. Everyone's a good wrestler, and that is the character. And then occasionally you get something silly come in, and I'm like, that's my stuff.
You don't have people with flash that look like they stand above everybody else anymore. They all kind of look the same with flashy types, and I don't know. Just that's my opinion.
I think that's why guys like in main roster nowadays, that's why guys like Drew stands out, because he does, he looks different to everyone. And I'm not just picking on him because he's also Scottish, but he looks different. He's got the kilt, he's got the cool demeanor, and that stands out to everyone. I mean, Seth Rollins is probably the same because he's got big flash as well. And then, yeah, there's just a bunch of really good wrestlers otherwise, without really much of difference between them. You can put them in any spot, really, and then that's, they're doing the same job.
I find too with Seth, there has been other guys that were flashy like that, mm-hmm. just maybe not so quirky with their hair and stuff, you know what I mean? But there was other guys that were flashy like that, but it doesn't, to me, he doesn't separate as a character.
Right.
He's just a wrestler that talks good on the mic. I don't know. You can disagree with me too. There was one time where everybody was character. I don't know. It just seemed like a little more cartoon, and that's when it seemed like wrestling was really, I don't know. It was a little cartoonish, but at the same time, it was savage because it was the attitude era.
It's
into the next era.
So the next era seemed to kind of blend the attitude era into the new gen, where you got kind of the big colors, but you got the big characters at the same time blended in with it. That's the stuff I liked. I like things like Viscera when he was the world's largest love machine. That's just like, it's just fun. That's what it should be. Yeah. I mean, I was like an early teen at the time when I was watching it, but still, it was just fun to watch.
Yeah. I don't find it as fun when you watch their promos and stuff backstage. It just, I like to say we had a little more fun when we got to film stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We got to ad lib a little more, you know, and get to have fun with it a little more.
So you mentioned the Spirit Squad, which goes into the point where I mean, I was always already a fan of the Highlanders, but I got to see you, and that was important to me. So it was 2006. It was my 16th birthday present. That's what it was. I got tickets to go see WWE Live and AECC in Aberdeen. And it was the first night in Aberdeen. You did two. And it was yourselves teaming with Ric Flair against the Spirit Squad. And I told the story to Rory as well, but it's a story that was a night that I love because my parents took me. And my dad just doesn't like wrestling. It was never his thing. No, he didn't like it.
Yeah.
My mom liked it when it was on, and she loved that whole dynamic because it was. She always says it's the most redneck experience she's ever had, because it was just a bunch of guys, just a bunch of people shouting at cheerleaders, and Ric Flair standing there going, "You're a homo. You're a homo." Couldn't get away with it now, but you're a homo. And it was just like, oh my God, this is wild. So during that time, you teamed with Flair. You also teamed with Roddy Piper. How was that as a adopted Scotsman getting to team with Roddy and Ric Flair?
Well, that was, you know, that I want to say that was November, was it? That year. And yeah. That was just a memorable time because Rory got to go back to Scotland and wrestle there. And that meant a lot to him and Rory, you know, me and we meant a lot to each other. And we got to experience, I got to tag up. It would have been nicer to wrestle him and, you know, win him, beat him for the title. But I got to be in the ring with Ric Flair and Roddy Piper. And those were guys I grew up with. Like Roddy was my first favorite. And then Macho Man was there too, but Roddy was my first favorite. Like I can remember going with Roddy all the way back till I'm like 8 years old. You know, Macho Man, same, but Ric Flair, same. I used to have cards when I was a kid, maybe around eight to ten. I used to buy these cards and we used to get they had cards of all the territories and they were all in one thing, and they had all the guys, Jake the Snake, Terry Taylor, like it had all of them. And I used to look at the bags. I was in with Ric Flair and Roddy Piper. It's amazing.
As far as
I don't even know what to say.
I was gonna say for mind blowing moments, is that pretty much one of the pinnacles, one of the top ones?
Well, it is a mind-blowing moment and just all around awesomeness. But one of the coolest things was Ric Flair came in with one of Rory's kilts and into the ring and took it off, and we did the same thing in Glasgow, and it was just amazing.
It's a moment. Well, what's that now? 2006. What's that? 18 years ago. And it's still one of my favorite shows I've ever been to, just because I got to see you guys. I got to see Jeff Hardy's my other favorite and longtime favorite. Yep. So I got, that was like everything I could have wanted in a wrestling show for my first one. It ticked it off, and just fantastic. And you got to see Ric Flair's arse, which, you know, I think that's probably a lot of people have seen it at this point, probably into the millions, but still it was interesting to see it live in person. Yeah, so I remember Rory saying that was a very special tour because he got to go home and he was with you guys. When it came to after Crime Time came in and you're now down the pecking order of things because Crime Time was the new hot thing, was always a case of you guys still just always working towards each other's goals and making sure that you guys were still in the conversations when it came to any tag team matches that were available?
Well, basically what happened was when Crime Time came along, you know, they needed guys to beat. So they brought it, you know, and, you know, we, There's times where we beat Kane and Murdoch, and I want to say we beat Shelton and Big Vis, or sorry, not Charlie and Big Vis. But we had some decent matches and had some good times, but we ended up kind of going to heat and just always being on heat, beating up people. And that was, the guys trying to get in. The thing is, I know Vince still liked us because we could keep the crowd and get them into it. So we ended up in a good spot, but after a couple of years, it didn't get any better and it just got worse.
Mm-hmm. Was there ever a conversation of you guys beating the Spirit Squad for the titles? Was that ever thrown at you?
I really thought it was going to happen in Toronto. But I want to say maybe a couple weeks before that in New York City, I might have got drunk and might have pissed someone off. I think that might have happened. I got really hammered in New York City and it's kind of unprofessional. And I was pretty hungover at work and had to go do a couple appearances that morning. And I wasn't originally scheduled for the appearance. Mickey James couldn't do it, but sometimes sometimes you wonder if that shit's set up, just excuse my language, because people are going to bury you to go farther than you. And, I was out drinking. Even though I showed up and everything, it didn't look good to me. I'm pretty sure I smelled like booze backstage at Madison Square Garden the day we did the match with Piper. So I've had a lot of time to go over my career and stuff and know that, they don't ever tell you when you're in trouble, but, I might have became unreliable because I like to party.
Right. Yeah. And like you've said, it is a cutthroat business. So if they found a reason to, tattle on you, to say,
I was hammered. Maybe I was hammered and someone knew I was hammered. And so maybe, that person's sick that was supposed to do it. So, we'll get the Highlanders to fill in. And I can't say no that I'm, you get heat pretty easy. So, but at the same time, Crime Time, Vince saw Crime Time and liked him. So it kind of could have been the booze. It could have been, you just never know.
Is there anything that, is that a time that you regret, or are you more of a case of you have been able to reflect and go, well, that's just part of the journey that I've taken and here I am now?
Well, I just know that there was a lot of instances where I would drink and party and carry on, and I'd show up to TV the next day and then all of a sudden we got a match, and there was a lot of times we didn't. If it was just us beating up somebody, it didn't matter on heat. But then we'd get, there's an instance, I think we got in there with Caden Murdoch. We got to beat him in South Carolina. It was a Roddy Piper tribute. And I want to say I came off the top rope. We pinned him somehow. But that night before, I was out drinking with one of the Spirit Squad members. And, I don't know if I – you just – when I reflect back, I could see, like, someone can smell your booze the night before and you don't have such a good time in the ring. You're becoming unreliable and this guy likes to party. And Bruce Pritchard said it on his podcast that Robbie liked to party and he was right. And I used to think it was weed smoking. And weed smoking has nothing to do with it. I really like to drink.
Mm-hmm. Did you feel you're always reliable in the ring, though? You wouldn't have put yourself in a position to be unreliable with other people.
Well,
it's just a case of just stuck to you.
I believe I was reliable in the ring, but there was a couple times where me and Rory were thrown under the bus where it was someone else's screw ups and we got thrown under the bus, and so that kind of put us in a position where we can't rely on them.
Right.
Again. Like I've reflected on my whole career, so I can pinpoint a lot of things that, I know, and that's just how the business is.
I think if you, if I suppose if you have regrets about it, then
no, I got no regret. I got no regrets because I have a better life than most guys that were there for a long time.
Mm-hmm. And you're still walking. As
well. Yeah, and I'm 51 years old and I can do the splits.
I'm 33 and I can't. So I think if I go down, I'm not coming back up. So for that time then, all that stuff's happening. Rory got injured. You ended up on a little bit of a singles run. I think you're randomly in that 17-on-2 tag team match that was one of the more random things in that time of Raw. I think against John Cena and Andy Orton, I think it was.
Yes, it was.
So from that point onwards, I think you end up with a tag team in Charlie Haas. It was very just need a body. Did it feel that way? It was kind of like if there's a spot open, they went off. Oh, we'll just put Robbie in there. Or
and that was cool because you know you're getting beat by John Cena and stuff, so it didn't matter, like Randy Orton and John Cena, so that doesn't matter. I did do a lot of dark matches too, where I got to work with like R-Truth and a few other guys. I did have a real nice match with Charlie Haas on the end of Heat. I think Rory was injured then, and Heat was finishing up. Me and Charlie Haas had the main event. Unfortunately, he put the mask on, did something, and he beat me. But I know before Rory tore his pec, we were being used a lot, but being used a lot in minutes for guys that, you know, like, getting beat by the Midget and Mick Foley the Midget and Fit Finley. And, you know, so that was getting to the time where it wasn't fun anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, I liked being used where it was, you're getting used for a little bit because you're making money and you're being used. But then there was a time we were being used and for minutes at a time and in bad positions. So you knew that, like, I felt that when we were getting beat by Midgets, we were on our way out the door before Rory got injured. Don't know if it's the case or not, but then I went and did my infamous TNA show up. And at that point, I didn't like my job anymore. I didn't want to be there. And there's been a couple times in my life where I call it a case of the effets, where you don't care what, you got to do what's good for you and what's going to clean your soul and make you feel good. And getting fired was one of the nicest things that ever happened at that time.
Well, we wouldn't do a whole podcast without mentioning that, unfortunately, even though you probably talked about it to death. But just before we get to that, though, it's a double-edged sword that you're in with Hornswoggle, which was a comedy character, but you got to wrestle someone like Finlay, who you would have seen growing up, or Mick Foley, or Jim Duggan or something like that. So it did. It must have been kind of like, yeah, it kind of cancelled each other out. You're doing 2 minutes, but you get in the ring with Foley. All right, it's cancelled out then. Cool thing, bad thing, nothing at the same time. So yeah, let's get into it. TNA, 2008, I think it was. I've written it down somewhere. Jeff Jarrett spoke about it a couple of years back on his podcast during a Q&A. Pretty much the case of if it was pointed out to him that you were in the crowd and he wondered why you weren't backstage. Oh, you're in the crowd. Well, you don't care then. So stick in the camera.
so basically, TNA, and they never, and I'll just say it, they never been a real threat to WWE or anything. And even when they had money, they were never a threat. Their ratings were never really much of anything when it came to WWE ratings. But they would, I want to say, like in other businesses, because I've been a salesman in another business where I see everybody shit talks everybody. Mm-hmm. Basically, thought it was going to give them ratings and do something, and it did nothing.
Yeah.
It didn't do anything for him. But at the same time, I saw a couple people I knew there. And then I shouldn't have been there, but I had the case of the efforts at the time. And it was like, I thought they put me in a, like, they kind of set me up, but at the same time, I thought they were putting me in a spot where I wouldn't be on camera.
Yeah.
So it was kind of, it was like the setup, and then they showed me on camera. That's why I was like, because that's when I was there and I had my head down, I was like, I don't think I should be here. This is going to be bad. But at the same time in my life, I didn't want to be there anymore. And the only thing I think that really caused by being there, John Laurinaitis or John Laryngitis, he never ever really liked us. Vince was who liked us. And I think that incident might have, I don't know if like me and Rory would have went back or me going back as a single, but I think that hindered me ever being, it kind of blackballed me with the office when John Laryngitis was there to ever be looked at again.
I mean, TNA thing's weird in itself because I again enjoyed it because it had the big characters. That was, as I've established quite comprehensively, that's what I like. I mean, if there was ever a time to kind of maybe spike your rating a little bit, would have been when you got fired, was to have you back in, just to build it as a story of some sort. But nope, they just put you on camera, and that was it. And the internet was in its infancy when it came to the message boards or stuff like that. So that was kind of where all the buzz was, but it didn't really do anything for TNA's ratings, which is just
It's funny you say the buzz. The internet creates a buzz, but the internet isn't the whole universe. Mm-hmm. And I'm not talking to WWE or AEW. I know AEW's more social media, internet-based. But the internet creates a buzz, but half these, like, I've seen a few things lately and I feel sorry for it. It's like, you know, WWE does take a guy and then kind of build him instead of just throw him out there and with no lackluster. Like, you know, during a match and there was nothing, no build-up to it. Like AEW. Like Edge and Christian have had a build up and did their thing, but some of these new stars that came in, they just got thrown in and they're in a match. Like, might have been some build up. Like, he's the new kid coming in, someone jumps him, you know, like creates a little story instead of just coming in and beating somebody.
Yeah, that's, I think that's one of my many. AEW, just, it's not for me. As I've established now, it's not for me. It's not a company that's my style of wrestling I like. But that is the thing. It's this week. It's some wrestler. Oh, they've wrestled in this place. Cool. Right. What? Why do I need to support them then? Why? You know. And you know, WWE does sometimes do that as well. But they at least have NXT where they kind of have the wee build up and then they come out and you go, oh, I've recognized that person from NXT, and that's that. It's a bit of that and WWE references.
I think the coolest build up could be, because the story of TNA and me is talked about a lot. I've actually been on Jeff Jarrett's podcast and we've done a podcast together, one of his ad frees, and I believe that it would be cool if I could get with the right people and pitch it that, you know, Jeff Jarrett's at AEW and I just come and just to try and get a little revenge to build up something for a pay-per-view. If you build it up over a month or two and then have it at a big pay-per-view and then just blow it all off, like, or you build it a couple pay-per-views. I don't have to beat him, but I can get revenge.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And then all of a sudden, my indie stock goes up and everybody wants to use me again for 2 or 3 years.
Well, I mean, the thing was, the build-up, there was a little build-up like on radio things with him and Grado. And you could even bring the threes, the Highlanders and Grado, against Jarrett's group kind of thing. And there is little individual stories being thrown in there. I mean, it doesn't have to be, you'd have to win. And it doesn't have to be one big match on the card, but if you throw it in there, it's got a little bit of recognition. I mean, I would love it, but again, I believe
it would get a good internet. It would bring people that know the whole incident. It would bring some people just to see it.
I mean, because what were we at? 16 years later, and we're still, it's still getting talked about as one of the big taboo things that TNA did.
Yeah, and really, it's not taboo because everybody does it anyhow. Right? They don't. They might sit farther up and never get caught on camera, but nowadays they get caught on somebody's phone.
Yeah, okay, well, because it got brought up again like 2 weeks ago because when Mercedes Moné made her debut, people were getting pictures of Bailey and that in the VIP seats watching on and celebrating, and the big discourse was went off well back in however long, how many years ago it was, that was a no-no. That was a big thing on the internet, and nowadays it's just...
I'm the only one that really got shit for it, and like really hard shit, and it stuck because John Laurinaitis didn't like us. And if I would have been able to sit in front of Vince and talk to him, I probably would have been able to go back one day.
And I mean, if you pitched it right, you probably could have just spun it into making some money. You know, even if it was a couple of weeks of eating shit a little bit just to put your stock back in kilter. But, you know, it would have been something out of it. Even if it was heat, it would be something out of it.
After me and Rory didn't do too many tag matches, I ended up dyeing my hair, doing a whole other character, and basically taping stuff in a swamp, like a swamp type bayou character, and then I sent it to the office, and I showed up in Louisville. I got backstage, and I was in Buffalo backstage. I got backstage a few times, but they wouldn't use me, but I would send stuff, and then one time I got backstage again, and John Laurinaitis caught up with me and said, listen, you can't come here no more, I'm gonna throw you out. So I was like, yeah, I guess I'm not wanted anymore at all.
So what you're saying is you were the inspiration behind Bray Wyatt, Wyatt family.
I know my partner said it before, and I did a video of stuff, but I know he came out after, and you know, maybe they could have got a hold of that and show, you know, they can show him and he can come out, and that's just how wrestling is. I got no, you know, if I was inspiration, that's awesome, because he did awesome.
He did. The initial Wyatt family stuff was just chilling to watch. So then,
and I could have been part of that, at least been in the family, because the way I looked at the time and how I presented myself. I probably could have been right in there with those boys.
Again, I think one of those internet things came out, and it was Harper and Rowan, and there was just things of like a big hairy burly man and a big bald burly man with a beard, and then it would be them next to yourselves kind of things. Like things stay the same as they go around in wrestling, it seems.
Now they got the what are they called, the Viking Warriors.
Yes, that was the other
one. Another Rory and Robbie type.
nothing's original in wrestling. That's what seems to be. So post WWE life, then, Big Johnny Ace gave you your marching orders, and that was it. What was your plan from that point? Was it a case of doing?
I actually lived off indie wrestling full time right up to 2014. Then I took a sales job for 8 years, bought a couple different houses, did a lot of sales. I did the odd wrestling show from 2014 to 2021, I would say, maybe one or two a year. And then over the last 2 years, I've probably done 160 matches.
Jeez. Wow. So the passion was still there, just it wasn't, what you were doing wasn't what you wanted to do. So
and now I'm in a position where, you know, I don't really have to have a job, but I like to go and perform, and I get to go on shows I want to go to, and I can turn down work, And I'm in good shape, and that's why I'm doing the wrestling. Plus, I have always loved doing it. When I did the sales, it didn't give me a lot of time to do it anymore because I was making way more money than wrestling was. But I was fortunate enough to save and do a couple of good real estate deals and get myself in a good situation where I'm very fortunate because I don't have any bills. Basically, I don't owe for my house. I don't owe for my car. I'm living the life, and like I say, I'm fortunate about it because, you know, it has, the wrestling does pay the bills too, and I pay taxes on it.
So you're slipping that in there just in case anyone's watching it going, well, let's go check his tax forms.
Well, the thing is, if you put it on social media, you've got to trace that you're working, and there's no sense lying. And in the end, like, I know some guys in England that got caught years ago saying, oh, I haven't been working and collecting unemployment, but they're wrestling on Tuesday and it's on social media the next day. They can't say anything.
I remember that. I don't remember who it was, but I do remember that story popping up somewhere. Yeah.
There was a guy that happened to in England. So I didn't have to work when I moved. I moved to the East Coast. I don't really have to work, but as soon as I started wrestling, when you're selling merchandise and making money, it's like, well, might as well record it all. And it's not hard. I did it in WWE. And when I did indies after WWE, I had enough work that, you know, I didn't go get a job where, you know, someone was paying me and then I got papers at the end of the year. It's just all coming in cash. So.
It sounds amazing. To be honest, it sounds, here I am in my office and talking to wrestlers, and it's great to hear that. It's a good story to have. It's not like one of the downtrodden stories you hear on Dark Side of the Ring now. It's you had your run, you can still make money off that run. And you've done your site, your I was gonna say side hustle, but that's where your main income was, and you're living, you can wrestle when you want to,
And that's why I think it would be really good to maybe, like, if I could get a little spot with Jeff Jarrett to do something that could give me, you know, a chance to get out on indies that I haven't been and work, you know, another 2 years and then call it a day. You know, I'm 50. I was 51. What's today's date? The 28th. So yeah. I turned 51 4 days ago. I guess I lied earlier in the show. I said three days ago, but I'm 51 now. And, you know, if I could get a couple more years of wrestling and have fun doing it, it'd be great.
I think if anyone's watching this, they'll be surprised that I'm the younger one, the two of us, because yeah, they're in phenomenal shape and I'm just round.
And the best thing is, like, me and Rory are going to New York City last weekend of May, first week of June, like into June, where we're going to reenact the very first Highlanders Coming to America video at Liberty Island. And then we're doing a virtual signing for that weekend. And so we're still active, you know, and we get around. So yeah, hopefully all the people out there watching, they might want to bring me in or something.
That's amazing. That sounds great. So going into that wilderness time of you just wrestling when you want to, as you want to, and using that time. I was looking through the results and that, and I was seeing that you technically beat DX, you know, so there was that. Against Billy Gunn and X-Pac, I think it was, up in Ontario, and you faced the Nasty Boys as well. And when you were getting brought in, were you able to, I don't know, find young guys to work with to try and impart some advice? Was that where people come up to you to try and get advice? Obviously not how to get fired, but try and get some advice while you're in the locker rooms.
Like you're talking after on the indies.
Yes. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I like to help. I like to help people. You know, one thing that a lot of guys, you know, when they ask for your advice, they don't like it when you give it to them. But I like to help the young guys along. I do a lot of that out here. I wrestle on pretty much in the Nova Scotia, New Brunswick area of Canada. And I help a lot of the guys if they want input, because, you know, they're our next generation, and you know, they do need help. And I like to give the criticism they need. Like, some people say, oh, it looks good when it doesn't. And wrestling needs to be impactful. Like, boom. Like, when you sit in the crowd, you want to know, you want to see, like, from the start, as soon as they lock up, it's a lockup. Like, you know, I locked up with Rene Dupree not too long ago. And when we got in the ring, it's like two bulls locking up. And then when we get there, we're like, but all that, everybody thinks when we lock up, it looks real right off the bat. Like, ooh. Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you faced a lot of guys in there. You have the Midas touch, it seems, when we're going through your opponents. Like I say, The Miz was in there. Sean Spears was in there. In OVW, you had the likes of CM Punk, Santino, when he was Boric's Alexiev. Ryback is, I mean, okay, maybe not all Midas touch in there, but you had Ryback. And nowadays, is there anyone that you've locked up with that you're like, you know what, this could be a guy. This could be a guy that I could see being national.
I haven't really too much lately. I think the guys out here got a lot to go. There's one guy out here that is pretty impactful in his wrestling, but he's never got the break. Maybe, you know, it might be his height or whatnot, but in wrestling, there's a certain game you got to play, and, you know, just because you have it doesn't mean you're going to get there. It's a lot of you know, being nice and baby facing people, and, hey, you know, becoming buds. But a lot of guys out here, I still think they got a long way to go. But the internet world, of course, boosts them up like the greatest of all time and this and that. When I watch them wrestle, if you're not looking like, to be honest with you, you need to look like solid WWE matches. Mm-hmm. to get my attention and to get their attention, I think. But there's some guys, they'll be there soon.
You're speaking about Nova Scotia, and this is, again, just a tangent for myself here, but back in 2004, my grandparents, it's a weird setup, but anyway, grandparents, I'll say that for the sake of ease here, were in Nova Scotia. I went over there, and it's a very beautiful part of the world, because went to Clementsport is where they lived, and we went to Halifax for a day and all that kind of stuff. And it's just it was the summer, it was idyllic, it was just, as a 14-year-old, it was fantastic. So it's a nice place to kind of set up home.
It's a beautiful spot, but for the last year we've had, it feels like being in London, because we've had no sunlight and it rains all the time.
Oh, so Scotland. Nova Scotia, New Scotland.
That's why they call it New Scotland, because it rains all the time.
Yeah,
it's been terrible. Last year we had so much rain, I thought we were going to get washed away.
But it seems kind of poetic that you started your wrestling career as not a real Scotsman, but you became in using that, those roots, and now you end up residing in New Scotland as well, in Nova Scotia. Yeah,
it's kind of cool. It's kind of cool.
So looking into the future then, before that, 2018, I noted that you kind of technically had your Impact debut when Border State Wrestling did a one-night-only thing with Impact Wrestlers. So again, I kind of doesn't quite close the chapter in that story, because we're going to get Jarrett involved, but it was kind of a nice thing to see on the match list, to see that you made it eventually.
Yeah, thank you.
But, you know, looking into the future, say you got that signing with Rory, and you're reenacting the first promo. Is there anything left on the bucket list to tick?
You know, I think I need to seriously think. Like, I'm in great shape right now. As long as I stay, if I'm ready like I am every day, I think that it would be really cool to maybe get that spot with Jeff Jarrett just to maybe call it a day. Maybe that's the very last thing I do. Like I say, I don't have to win. It's just got to be a revenge thing. And then the internet world talks about it for another 15 years.
And then why not?
I think with the world of the internet, it would probably draw attention. I'm not saying it's going to bring millions and millions of people, but it might draw some attention and people might want to come see it.
There you go. So Tony Khan, get the wallet out, get the bagpipes, get a bagpiper. And I think the other thing that I think Rory was saying from remembering from our chat was he loved just us to finish up in Scotland. Would that interest you doing a mini Scottish tour with the two of you and kind of closing his chapter?
Absolutely.
And when it comes to the internet, is there any tag teams that you've spotted that you think, yeah, me and Rory could probably do a lot of magic with them?
You know, I think I would like to work with, I've worked with them recently, Billy Gunn's boys.
All right,
I've had a match with, I've tagged up with Billy recently, well, maybe 8 or 9 months ago, I can't remember. But we did a match, and I had a lot of fun with them, and I think Rory and I could have some good fun with them.
There we go. So plenty of ideas that we've thrown out for promoters listening. Get Scottish Tour, Jarrett, the Guns, you know, plenty. Lots of things to do before.
And the thing with Jarrett too, if Rory can't wrestle, because sometimes, you know, that was a year ago you talked to him. I don't know how he's feeling about wrestling. I'm sure he would. But if he couldn't, maybe he would do the with Jarrett. Maybe it's a revenge thing and Rory's involved and that's how we get our revenge.
Yep.
You know, there's things.
Absolutely. But I think we can wrap up here then. I think I've ticked off pretty much most of my notes here. And I think that's probably enough time to, I don't know. I'm running out of brain power here. It's 9 o'clock in the evening. I've got near 2-year-old and he takes up most of my
brain space. Yeah, I get it.
But it's been an absolute pleasure to speak to you. I'm so glad that we got this set up and I've completed the Highlanders. So who's next? Who's next in my list of Scottish wrestlers? Drew, come on, Drew. Let's get you on next. but for those that are unaware, you mentioned the signing, but is there anything else you want to plug coming up? Is this coming up April 8th?
Well, if guys are looking to book a Highlander and, you know, if they're not looking for the tag team, I still do singles. You can catch me at Highlander Robbie on Instagram. And my Facebook's Derek Robbie McAllister Coach. That's both my names together. And I work on, I got a couple shows a month coming up. The shows I'm doing, we usually do 400 or 500 people. And that's why I prefer to do those shows and pick and choose what I want to do because I want to go and have a lot of fun and at the same time be able to interact with the fans and sell a little merchandise.
That's it. I'm sure there's still people coming up to you even now remembering the Highlanders and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, you get the odd one or you make new fans.
That's how it keeps going. But perfect, yeah. Thank you very much for taking time to speak to me today. It's been an absolute blast.
Thank you very much.